Greetings, fellow adventurers. I'm Max with Peak D&D.
And I'm Ben. Welcome to the Peak.
We're here in the Rocky Mountains helping you elevate your game in 5th edition's Dungeons & Dragons and life.
In this episode of Peaked Interests, we're talking about choosing the best background.
So, let's roll some initiative and get to it.
Now, backgrounds are important. Everyone you meet has one. Oh, I was waiting for it to happen.
Yeah, I know, man. Me too. I wonder if...
I mean, maybe...
Oh, cool. Yeah, we're good, I guess.
Cool.
What the f***? Can't believe it, you! I don't believe this, mistress! What the sh**? Hasn't anyone ever told you it's rude to sneak up on a unicorn in its grove while it's enjoying its favorite podcast? Come to think of it, that's not even supposed to be possible. Who are you? Why are you here? What business do you have with I, Saint Gumdrop Lollipop Snuggly Face, Tiny Pants? What? Yes, of course I have every right to use that title. I am a lawful good divine being, for Cuthbert's sake. I couldn't lie about that if I wanted to. What? No, no. Quite easy, really. I simply submitted the appropriate number of topics to Ignorant and Uninformed, and one day, a totally legit and valid certificate of sainthood magically appeared in my grove. Now be gone! Jeff was just starting to talk about how much he loves Omega!
Ah, there it is every time.
Backgrounds. So important, the player's handbook devotes 20 pages to them starting on page 124.
It seems like there are at least a few sprinkled into every new 5e book that comes out.
At the time of filming, 5ebackgrounds.com has almost 60 different ones listed. Shout out John for the good work and helping the community.
With so many options, it can be hard to choose the best one for your character.
Ben and I are going to give you some tips and pointers to help simplify that process and make it easier.
But before we go there, though, let's step back and take a look at why backgrounds are so important in 5th edition.
Backgrounds didn't exist in previous editions of Dungeons & Dragons, at least not in any of the ones that I played.
Until recently, it was up to the player to come up with their backstory from scratch, with zero guidance from the player's handbook.
Sure, you had your age and gender and race and class, but... after you decided 25-year-old female half-elf cleric, it was a totally blank canvas.
And blank canvases are intimidating, especially if you're new to the medium you're working in this case, creating a character.
And as is the 5th edition way, Wizards of the Coast made this aspect of the game easier and more accessible.
This was a great move because, as Max and I said, your background matters. It's what grounds your character inside the story.
In the words of Terry Pratchett, if you do not know where you come from, then you don't know where you are. And if you don't know where you are, then you don't know where you're going. And if you don't know where you're going, you're probably going wrong.
And in the words of Cotton Eye Joe, where did you come from? Where did you go? Where did you come from, Cotton Eye Joe? This is what I mean by grounding your character in the story. The background you choose gives you an idea of who your character was before you took control.
Presumably, your character was living a normal life, going about their business, and then bam! You picked up the dice, put pen to paper, and took control.
Call it a charge or fated choice or a dramatic moment of import. This bifurcation point is where your character's life changed.
Instead of staying on the path they were on, they, or more accurately, you, decided to have them take a turn and start down a new one.
But your 25-year-old half-elf cleric lived 24 years and 364 days of her own before you decided to show up.
And these 24 years and 364 days were full of experiences that shaped who she was and what she was doing.
I like to think of Newton's first law of motion.
A robot may not injure a human being or through an action allow a human being to come to harm.
No. An object at rest will stay at rest. An object in motion will stay in motion at a constant velocity unless acted upon by an unbalanced force.
Right.
Yes, that one. Your character was in motion, pointed in a certain direction, doing certain things and making sense of the world in certain ways. Then you got there.
Did you just call me an unbalanced force?
I did, maybe.
Yeah, I've been called worse.
Well, but that's not exactly the point. See, your character's background is the direction that they were pointed in.
It's not like your character was an inanimate object. Their life was in motion, and then you showed up and changed their trajectory.
Exactly. Not only did they have a certain direction, but they also had a specific way of seeing the world and making sense of it.
By knowing who your character was before they were your character, you begin to understand what their world looked like.
A dwarf who grew up in the mines or on a root vegetable farm doesn't see the world the same as a halfling from the city.
Or a spoiled rich kid from an unloving home.
Now, the better you understand who your character was, the more you can bring to life who they are and who they're becoming.
This not only helps you be a better player, it helps your DM and the other players around the table.
Your DM by giving them opportunities to weave your past into their story.
Your other players by giving them something to riff off of and to get to know you.
Now, Jastian could talk to Illensworth about what he had to do to survive as an urchin out on the streets all on his own.
And anytime either of us need to distract Gord, we can just point to something and be like, is that a parsnip?
Now that you understand why backgrounds are so important, let's help you pick a good one.
A good background is of service to you and the story.
Simple enough, right?
A background that serves you is one that helps you have fun playing Dungeons & Dragons.
And as having fun playing Dungeons & Dragons means different things to different people should use different criteria to choose those backgrounds.
I have no shame in admitting it comes down to mechanics. Illensworth is an urchin because of the proficiencies it gave me.
I, on the other hand, made Jastian a noble because it fit the character concept that I already had in my head.
It's fun for me to play badass characters.
And it's fun for me to bring a character concept to life.
Both are choices that serve us, and we use different criteria to get to.
Serving the story is where I usually start. Jastian, the noble who spent time in Airedale, is who I wanted to bring to life.
Now for me, serving the story is a filter that I like to use.
What do you mean?
So I knew that I wanted to play a rogue. It was a class I hadn't been in 5th edition.
Mm-hmm.
Looking through the players, I liked what I read about halflings.
So you chose your class first? Now that sounds like a secret to always making a character you love.
And I knew we were playing a module called Into the Fae that revolved around a city, and I knew I wanted to be a badass, which means being good at things.
Now that narrowed down the choices you had considerably, I'd imagine.
Yeah, totally. It basically left me with criminal, charlatan, and urchin. After reading through those, I went with urchin.
Once you've picked your background, it's time to come up with your backstory.
Which is a whole hell of a lot easier once you have your background.
It's almost like your background is the sketch or rough outline of your character, and your backstory is just a matter of connecting those dots and adding a little bit of color.
So the first sentence of the urchin background is, you grew up on the streets alone. All I did to come up with my backstory was ask, how? What series of events caused this?
So you connected those dots and colored in the details.
It wasn't a huge leap from growing up alone on the streets, doing what he had to do to survive, to being a rogue. It fit.
And I approached Jastian a little differently. I knew we were playing Into the Fae and that I wanted to be a warlock, a class that I hadn't played in 5th edition. When I saw Archfey as a potential patron, I jumped at it.
Sounds like serving the story to me. You knew warlock, saw ties to Fae, and went with it. How did you settle on noble?
Now that was because of the knot I chose. Delinquent.
If that sentence made zero sense to you, check this out.
So I had warlock, troublemaker, and browsing through the player's handbook, I saw noble and thought, rich kid, likes to have a good time, gets into trouble because he's bored.
Were there any other backgrounds that you considered? It seems like a criminal, charlatan could have worked.
I started with addition by subtraction. My first step is eliminating the ones that I knew didn't fit, like sailor, outlander, bunch of others.
Ben brings up a good point. Remember, there are at least 60 different options you can choose from. 50-ish probably won't actually serve you or the story.
Once I bid adieu to guild artisan, folk hero, and the like, noble popped out as the one I could have the most fun with playing, so I chose that. There you have two similar but different approaches to choosing a good background and creating a backstory for your character. Now, we're gonna switch it up and talk about how to do that for you.
That's right. We're gonna take everything we just went over and apply it to real life.
Now, unlike Dungeons & Dragons, where there is a certain set number of backgrounds to choose from, real life is a little different.
Yeah, while 5th edition may boast 60 and counting, real life has a bit more.
Not only does it have more, but they aren't codified or written down in a handy player's handbook for you to just browse through.
RealLifeBackgrounds.com isn't a thing. At least, I don't think it is. Probably should have checked that out before this.
And just like the first step in choosing a background for your character was looking through your options, that's where we're going to start for you.
To do this, you're going to need to turn around.
Grab some paper, start a new doc. Every now and then, open your voice memo app and start talking stream of consciousness. It doesn't matter.
All you're looking to do is look back on your life and come up with a potential list of backgrounds.
We're about to bare our souls on the internet, on the YouTube, so don't feel weird. Don't be, this makes me feel uncomfortable. What will people think? You're in your house. We're on the internet. Come on.
Yeah, this is going to be here forever. Ben and I are giving you advantage on every save you need to make versus fear from here on out. You got this.
You got this.
Ben, you ready?
Oh, I'm starting.
Yeah, it's your line.
Can I have advantage? Okay. My potential backgrounds. Actor, son, father, brother, Boy Scout, Eagle Scout, one-upper, religious zealot, Civil War reenactor, technical director, husband, carpenter, optimist, romantic ne'er-do-well, and bifurcation point.
My turn. All right. Only child, son, friend, outcast, who's who among America's teens, black sheep, fat kid, hopeless romantic, Jew, world traveler, writer, hermit, disappointment, bartender, server, hippie, nerd, gamer, weirdo, people pleaser, warrior.
That is quite the list.
Hey man, we're not here to pull punches, we're here to help.
Got this. Now that we've got our list of potential backgrounds, it's time to choose.
Just like for your character, the backgrounds you choose, you get more than one in real life, and the backstory you create matter.
Because just like in Dungeons & Dragons, these choices put you in motion in a certain direction and affect how you see the world.
Using examples from our lists, a warrior and an optimist can be in identical situations and see them totally differently.
To an optimist, looking at your phone for the first time in the morning is exciting because you're probably gonna get some good news or some fun texts.
And for a warrior, it's with sinking dread you snatch up your phone and start scrolling because it's ever apocalyptic.
Doom scrolling is real. Same event, different experiences, and different interpretations.
Both ground you in a story and point you in a very specific direction.
When it comes to choosing your backgrounds in real life, the same rules of service apply. You want to choose one that serves you and your story.
Serving you means backgrounds like optimist that help you feel good about yourself.
Serving your story means backgrounds that set you up in the direction of who you want to be and the life you want to live.
Using that criteria, go through your list and Marie Kondo it.
Does this background bring me joy?
Separating the backgrounds that make you feel good from the ones that make you feel bad is not hard. It's like DC 2.
There are three on my list that don't make me feel great about myself and my life. They all started out with good intentions, but proved to be bad background choices. Romantic ne'er-do-well, Civil War reenactor, and religious zealot.
Okay. On mine, there's hopeless romantic, disappointment, warrior, people pleaser, fat kid, and outcast. Unless you spell it with a K.
Ah. Whereas Jastian and Illensworth have it easy, and I've probably got a few of Max's on my list too, Ben and Max have it a little harder than our D&D characters.
In game, your characters don't have multiple backgrounds that don't serve them that keep popping up.
In D&D, you choose to make one choice about your background and then you're done. But in real life, it's a constant choice, one you're presented with over and over again, and one you choose every day.
Fortunately, the more you make this choice, the easier and more automatic it becomes, making it extra important to be intentional.
Before Max and I show you what choosing your background in real time looks like, a reminder. Denying who you've been and what you've done is never a good decision.
Evasion, while an awesome class feature, isn't a healthy life strategy. The only way to make sure your background is serving you and your life is by owning your past.
Becoming aware of the background that you're using is the first step.
Awareness usually is.
You see, every background comes with a script, a story.
To illustrate what we're talking about, I'm gonna go with Fat Kid. What about you?
Well, you know I love history, so let's go Civil War reenactor.
I'll go first this time.
Okay.
May I introduce to you Middle School Max.
Oh, dude, look at those cheeks. What a little put 'em there.
Take it in, take it in. As you might imagine, it was not on my door all the cute middle school girls came knocking.
Now that picture barely even looks like you anymore. Are you sure you're the same person?
That's the point. Uh-huh. Every early romantic rejection served to cement a story into place about who I was and how I fit into this world.
For real?
Dude, last week I saw someone I was attracted to and my thoughts went like this. Oh, she's cute. I should go talk to her. Why? What's the point? She's not interested. Why would she be?
Damn, dude.
Yeah. This is an example of an old background that doesn't serve me or my story that pops up and prevents me from living the life I want.
So you didn't go talk to her?
Dude, hell no. I stood there letting this background and its perspective and beliefs that are almost 30 years old rule my world.
Okay. Here's my example, and a tool that I've been using to choose my background in real time.
Let's hear it.
84 and 7 years ago, actually it was more like 17 years ago, I was involved in Civil War reenactments.
Start calling you country.
Maybe so. Like I said, I've always loved history, and that's how I got into reenacting in the first place.
Makes sense.
And I did learn a lot about history of the Civil War, and I also learned a little bit about modern day racism.
I mean, it's always kind of been the knock, at least from a Yankee perspective.
Sure, yeah. Now, there were jokes and hard ends thrown around quite frequently, and while I didn't actively participate, I did passively perpetrate. And in that, I didn't attempt to stop or correct this kind of behavior that I was seeing.
Damn, man.
Fast forward, and it's 2020, and George Floyd, and BLM, and I like to think of myself as a socially conscious, progressive person nowadays.
I've always considered you as such.
But every time people would tout the argument of heritage, not hate, in response to removing Confederate flags and statues in response to the current events, I was thrown back there, right in the middle of my reenactor background.
In what sense?
Well, that's the argument, the excuse that people would give for their racist behavior, that it was somehow preserving history or celebrating heritage.
Okay.
And I was struggling to reconcile this background with the person that I had become and I wanted to continue to be.
I get it.
Now, my friend ended up giving me some really good advice that really helped me. She told me, you're not responsible for your first thought, but you are responsible for your second thought and your first action. I realized that I was beating myself up and getting down on myself because my first thoughts weren't what I wanted them to be.
Yeah, I mean, like, first thoughts are always gonna be a reaction, right? They come from a background. It's a result of how we're programmed.
But our second thought and our first action, that's our power, our choice.
Choosing your second thought and first action is the real life equivalent of like taking control of your D&D character.
Exactly. It's that moment of fate where your character's direction changes from where they were headed to where you're leading them.
It separates the past of your character from their future. It's like their present, their now.
Put space between your first thought and your second thought and make a choice. That's how you change your background.
So recognizing your first thought and understanding it's coming from an old background is where you start.
Yeah, and next you determine if that background and its first thought is serving you and your story. But if it's not, getting mad at yourself doesn't help. Getting gentle does. You gotta forgive yourself.
Okay, then what?
Choose a second thought and a first action that reflect a background that does serve you and your story.
You make it sound easy.
I wish it were, but unfortunately, it's not. One thing that I've learned that helps is knowing what your alternate background choice would be. That is, what your second thought and first action you want to use is.
Okay, yeah, no, that makes sense. It's easier to fall back onto something you've already got than making something up on the fly.
So for you, have a second thought and a first action that serves you and your story ready next time you see a lady you might like.
Okay, all right, Ben, I appreciate that. I will let you know.
Like we said in the beginning, backgrounds point you and your character in a certain direction and influence how you see the world.
And just like in Dungeons & Dragons, some backgrounds you can choose don't serve you or your story.
But becoming aware of the background you're using in real time is like the moment you pluck your character out of their old routines and start them into a new life of new adventure.
It's the moment of control where you move from your backstory to your now story and start heading toward the person you want to be and the life you want to lead.
Because at the end of the day, that's what it's all about. Being who you want to be and living the life you want.
Becoming aware of old backgrounds, their stories, and perspectives is a big step in the direction of leading your life, not being led by it.
And when you catch your first thoughts from an old background rising to the top, don't get down on yourself. This isn't you failing, it's you succeeding.
The only way to choose your second thought is if you're able to notice your first.
Then, just choose a different background to use. One that serves you, your story, and your life.
Hey, thanks for sticking around and hanging out with me and Ben today.
Hopefully, we piqued your interests.
Maybe gave you something to help you out.
Let us know in the comments below if this made any sense to you.
Is there a topic you'd like to see us cover? Cast sending.
There's an email link in the description down there.
For more peak D&D content, roll to hit that subscribe button. Each of you who does, thank you. You have brought us closer to leveling up.
Make sure to drop the warnings around the notification bell so you don't get skipped and miss your turn.
Check back here every Wednesday and every Saturday for more Dungeons & Dragons content.
And help the channel by casting Bigby's thumbs up and liking the video. That works too. Until then, adventurers, keep on climbing.
And we will catch you next time up here at the peak. It sound right, boy.